Now we all are hearing a lot about Dockers and Kubernetes and all. First of all, let me tell you how this revolution has been started and how a Docker will help for developers, as testers, and operations team of DevOps. Okay, yeah. So initially, we used to have only a bare metal or physical servers, right? Like if someone wants to run an application, we need to purchase a server, the physical server. And we need to install the operating system on this. And we will be running OS. It can be a Windows or Linux or Unix operating system. And then we used to run our applications. So later of it, we used to run our applications. That is what we used to do till now in on the physical servers. If you take this, so this is my hardware which I have. Let us say it is hardware, NIC card. Okay, and then I have RAM. Yes, so many other things of hardware. So my operating system is installed on it, and then after I used to run my applications. Okay, so this is application one, and here I used to have another application. Okay, so this is how I used to run. Okay, so here what happened, since this is like physical server I have, so I used to run some certain applications. Now the problem is, let us assume, let us take one example in this scenario, and we'll understand why we are not able to go with the physical server and then why we need the virtual servers. So initially we used to have physical servers, and we used to run multiple applications, different applications. Let us say Apache web server, Tomcat, DNS, and DNS, Tomcat, Apache web server, mail server. So we have FTP server. So all these servers can be installed on your single physical machine. It depends upon the resource you have, the amount of RAM, the amount of hard disk, the amount of CPU you have. All these criteria need to be considered. That is the secondary part which we don't discuss. But here the concept is, we need to run multiple applications on a single physical server. But here the problem is, let us say there is a developer or a tester or an operations team. He need to create two applications, one with one version. Let us say here I want to install, let us take an Nginx web server. Here I need to install Nginx with 2.4 version. Let us take an example. Okay, and there is one more developer. We don't have any other physical server because my company is not affordable in purchasing another physical server, because all their billing, like all their what do we say, financially they have put all the resource on the single physical machine itself. So they purchased with all the specifications it required for to run your applications. Now what happened, unfortunately, like the other developer who is trying to develop, he wants to run Nginx 2.6 version. So here you need to run Nginx 2.6 version. So the problem is, a one physical machine cannot run two Nginx with two different versions. It is not at all possible on the physical server. Let us say you have a physical server and there is an operating system installed, and try to install Apache web server with one version. And next time, after a few days, there is another developer came up and he wants to test it with application with 2.6. He want 2.4 as a side, and he wants to run on 2.6 also his application. So then as an administrator, you can't do anything because you have only one physical server. You cannot run the same service, same application, same Nginx web server with two different versions, which is not possible in a physical server. So then they came up with a solution called virtualization. Okay, so in a virtualization, before talking about virtualization, we need to talk about hypervisors. Okay, so hypervisor is nothing but a piece of software which will be running on a physical machine. Okay, to be simple in diagrammatical format, I'll tell you in simple way. So let us say, assume this is your physical server. Okay, in this we have our operating system. Okay, the operating system will be communicating to the OS. I think that is a normal thing which we have discussed till now. Okay, this is a normal criteria. Now I want to run a virtual machine on top of physical machine. A virtual in the sense which is not physically existing, created by when someone is asking about you, what is virtualization, tell them that a device which is created by a piece of software is called as virtualization. A device can be anything. It can be a hard disk. Okay, it can be a RAM. It can be a CPU. It can be a VM. VM in the sense virtual machine. Any device which is created with a software, piece of software, is called as virtualization. Okay. Now here also this is a virtualization. So in this virtualization, now what is the advantage of that? Now this guy, like the operations team or tester or the developer, whatever it is, he will have his local laptop. Now he's an operating system like Windows, Mac OS, whatever it is. Let us have Windows or Mac in this. Mac in the sense it is a Unix kind of operating system. And then let us say I have Linux itself, the base operating system we have. Okay. Now, what happens? I need to run a hypervisor on this, and means I need to install it. Hypervisor package. Okay. So I need to be installing hypervisor on top of it. This hypervisor is called a software hypervisor. So in the current market now we have two types of hypervisors. Okay. One is called as hypervisor one. Some people will call like this hypervisor. Don't be confused. Hypervisor one. And the second one is called as hypervisor two. So hypervisor one is nothing but which is can also be called as, for your understanding. So this hypervisor one is called as hardware hypervisor. Hardware. And this is called as software. What is this hardware hypervisor and software hypervisor? Let me tell you. So hardware hypervisor in the sense, let me give here. Hypervisor 2 in the sense it is software. So hardware hypervisor and software hypervisor. So let us take one example and see what is hardware and what is software. Hardware hypervisor in the sense, when we went to the market and you purchased your physical server, it can be a laptop, it can be a like PC, whatever it is, and now you are installing the operating system. Now hardware hypervisor in the sense, we don't need to install any other operating system like Linux or Mac, whatever it is not required to install. A separate ISO is available for hardware hypervisor. For example, we have VMware ESXi. Okay. VMware ESXi. If someone knows like what is VMware ESXi, they can understand a bit more than compared to the normal persons. Because I don't want to waste time on explaining what is VMware ESXi and all. I'll just give a short description. Okay. Let us say you have took a physical server or a physical laptop, whatever it is, it's physical bare metal server. Okay, from the data center. Now directly we don't install any other operating system like Windows, Mac OS, whatever it is. A separate ISO is available for this. Okay. If you install that operating system, that ISO will take care of directly creating a physical resource. It will do a partition. Okay. Physical partition of your resource which you have in the bare metal server. That is called as hardware hypervisor. The best example for that is nothing but VMware ESXi. Okay. So this software doesn't, this VMware ESXi doesn't run any on any other operating system. It is just an operating system. Okay. So you can't see anything in that under that. Okay. So that is called as hardware hypervisor. Anyway, it's a piece of software which will create it. Now what is software hypervisor? So software hypervisor is nothing but, here the best example is nothing but, if you are aware of that, say here we have, right, I have installed an operating system in my laptop and now I want to run two virtual machines. One is with Windows and one is with Linux operating system. Another Windows I want to create. Then what we can do, we can install a software. That software is called a software hypervisor. Okay. And on top of it, you will create your virtual machines. Okay. Now you will be creating your virtual machines. Okay. So now what I can do, what are the disadvantages we have seen here can be implemented here. Now, what I can do, I can install OS in this virtual machine. I can install the OS, whatever the operating system I want. And then here I can run my application with of Nginx with 2.4 version. Okay. And then what I will do, I want to run 2.6 also. Then what I will do, I'll install the OS and then I will be installing Nginx here. Nginx with 2.6 version. Okay, now each and every server is independent. Now this is a virtual machine and this is the virtual machine. Okay, every virtual machine is having its own operating system with two different what do we say, Nginx versions. Okay, now this server is different and this server is different, but it is not physically existing. It is created by a software. That's the reason it is called as virtual machine. All the resources which are required for the server has been created by a software. So that's the reason it is called as virtual machine. Okay, so now the problem, so these are the advantages we have in the virtual machine creation. So I can run different operating system with a different like what are the applications I want. So software hypervisor, in the sense, what is the best example? In the current market we have Oracle VirtualBox. Oracle VirtualBox is one of the software hypervisor we have. Not only that, if you look at that, we have VMware workstation. Let us have Windows operating system right now. Okay, if I want to run a virtual machine, then this is the Oracle VirtualBox which I have. Let me show you that. See, this is my Oracle virtual machine. Okay, VirtualBox, on this I have run this many operating systems. Okay, I have Windows, Ubuntu, I have CentOS, I have Ubuntu 18.04 version, and these are the Kubernetes which I have installed. This is version v1.10.0. okay, so this, like, I can run multiple operating system, because every time I cannot purchase a new laptop for each and every operating system and then install it, right? I don't have resource for that. I cannot afford for it. So then what is the best solution I can do? I can install a software hypervisor and then run whatever VM I want. Okay, here it is platform independent. See, the operating system which is running in the physical server is called as guest host operating system. Host operating system. Okay, and the operating system which is running in this particular VM is called as guest operating system. Guest operating system. Okay, it is clear, right? We don't have any other operating system, right? Here, but here in virtualization, here this is your physical server. On physical server, we installed an operating system, right? That operating system is called as host OS. Okay, and we have installed hypervisor. It can be anything, like, okay, and then we have guest OS. Guest OS, in the sense, the OS which is installed on your virtual machine. Here I can install Linux, Unix operating system. Again here Windows Server 2012, okay, Windows Server 2014, I think we have it. So these many operating systems I can run. Again, number of virtual machines which we can run on the physical server depends upon the RAM you have, CPU capability we have, and then we have the hardware, okay, like hard disk. Okay, if you have only two CPU cores, you cannot run more than one virtual machine, right? How will you allocate one more CPU to your virtual machine? So physical server, it doesn't possible, right? So, and one more thing, let us say I have 10 GB of RAM in this physical server, and how many virtual machines I can run? Hardly like 3 to 4 if you are allocating 2 GB of RAM. Let us say here I have 10 GB of RAM. Okay, how many virtual machines I can run? If you have 2 GB, if you want to allocate 2 GB for all the virtual machines, hardly you can run approximately 3 we need to leave for your base machine. So totally 7. Okay, means 7 GB can be allocated to your virtual machine. Okay, in one virtual machine we can allocate 7 GB, or else if you want to allocate 2 GB, 2, 2, 2, 6 is covered, and then we can create one more virtual machine with 1 GB RAM. That's it. We cannot go beyond this, because your base machine should have some GB in order to load this particular all the applications, operating system. See, your base operating system is a major component, right, which will handle this hypervisor. Okay, and the only problem with this, let us see what are the disadvantages we have in virtual machines and why we are going for containers. Okay, the disadvantages in virtual machine is nothing but, let us say your physical server is down, is crashed, your virtual machine, let us say here the operating system is crashed, you cannot access your virtual machines. It is not possible, right? Obviously, when physical server is not running, you cannot access your virtual machines. Okay, this will impact all the applications which are running in the physical server. That is a major problem we have in the physical this virtualization. And apart from that, the more disadvantages are nothing but Let us say this is your operating system. We have a virtual machine. Okay, in order to create this virtual machine, approximately it will take 20 minutes to create. If you are manually trying to create or kickstart installation, whatever it is, it will take 20 minutes or 15 minutes to create a virtual machine. So when we are working in a production servers, if you are a tester, we need to test the application as soon as possible, right? So when you do your testing faster, the bugs can be identified and it will be reported to your developer, and developer will be fixing it, and then he will regenerate the code, and that code will be tested immediately. So this will happen only when the tester is doing much faster testing on the servers. When you are taking a 20 minutes of time in creating your virtual machine, how fast you will test your applications, right? So every time I want to test with the new operating system, then how it is possible? So whenever you are testing your application, right? So I need to test on a new operating system for the new code which is generated. So it is not possible on a virtual machines or a physical servers, because it will take certain amount of time. We are wasting a time in creating a virtual machine itself or a physical server itself. Okay, physical server is like too tough to create. Whenever you want to regenerate the code and test it, it is like bit. It is so tough to test the code every time with a new operating system. Okay, but in virtual machine, at least it has some advantages. Like though it will take 4 hours or 5 hours, then it is like somewhat advantage compared to your physical servers. Okay, but according to the developer or a tester, it is not so. It is waste of time of wasting 4 hours in order to test the code. Okay, so then that is one disadvantage we have in virtualization. And one more thing is nothing but, as if we talked about this, 10 GB of RAM resource. The resource will be used by virtual machine, and that cannot be increased dynamically. Let us say you have allocated, I'm talking about RAM. Hard disk can be dynamically allocated, CPU not. Okay. The RAM is nothing but, let us say here I have 10 GB RAM. Let me wipe out this. Let us assume that here I have only 4 GB of RAM in my base. Okay. 4 GB of RAM. Now, I have created 2 GB of server. Let us say I have created 2 GB operating system, virtual server, which is called a virtual server. Now, this 2 GB is allocated to your virtual machine. Okay. Now, your base machine will have only 2 GB, because 2 GB is allocated to your virtual machine, and your base machine will be having only 2 GB. But the problem which I have identified is this virtual machine which I have allocated 2 GB, it is not actually using the 2 GB. 500 MB itself it is using, 500 or 250 MB. Unnecessarily, we have allocated one more GB, like 1.5 GB to the virtual machine, which is not at all using it. Then you are wasting your resource on the virtual machine, right? So which is like cost effective, and the unnecessarily you are using the giving the resource to the virtual machine and not affecting your base machine. So that is the second disadvantage we have in the virtualization. Okay. Similarly, we have other disadvantage which is causing this virtual machine applications to move into the container technology. So now let us see what is container. Okay, if we start comparing with this, let me wipe out this. Actually, I don't save this. Okay, I will draw the diagram once again. Okay, now let us compare your virtualization and containers. First of all, let us see what is containers. Okay, containers are nothing but, okay, let us say this is your physical server. See, containerization can be done on physical servers and virtual machines or a cloud servers. You know what is a cloud server, like AWS, the servers which are created in the cloud, like AWS, Azure, OpenStack, Google Cloud, and Cloud9, Rackspace. So these are like providers of cloud. Okay. So even you can run your, you can install your containers software on that particular cloud servers or a physical machine or a virtual servers. Okay. Now, let us assume that this is your server or physical server or virtual machine, whatever it is. Okay. So there is an OS running in this particular physical server. Okay. Now, on this, we will be installing a software. Okay. That software will be your containers. Okay. Container package that in Linux by default will get with LXD. Okay. Or it can be a Docker. Okay, or it can be Kubernetes, okay, or it can be Docker Swarm, whatever it is. We have installed this software, okay. On this, on top of it, it will create a continuous file, okay. Now it is not required to run an operating system. Let us first see containers, okay. So this is my physical server. I have installed a package. See, Docker cannot be installed as a hardware virtualization, okay. It is a software virtualization, okay. Docker, Kubernetes, LXD. In Linux, by default, we have a LXD package which we can create using commands and containers, okay. The containers which are handled by a application is called as Docker, okay. Docker, using Docker commands, the Docker command will contact to the containers software, and then the container software will talk to the physical resources we have. Let us forget about this right now, okay. Now I want to install an application which we talked about, Nginx, right, with the different versions, okay. Then what I will do, I will install Nginx here. I will create a container with Nginx 2.4 version, and I will create an Nginx with 2.6 version, okay. Now this containers doesn't have any operating system. Without having operating system, how will you communicate to the hardware? What is the use case of operating system? As a human being, I cannot understand the hardware binary language, ones and zeros. So that's the reason the people have developed an operating system where a human being can convey his language. This language will be converted into binary language by using an operating system. In operating system, the main component which will take care of it is nothing but kernel. Kernel will take this particular task, okay. And what kernel does, it will take the information, it will give it to the physical hardware, and physical hardware, it will pick the information, and then it will display on your terminal, right? The way you are trying to contact to the operating system is your own language. We doesn't use any binary language, right? I will use English. Some people will use Chinese, okay, if it is supported. And some people will be using a different language, okay, Germany or whatever it is. The way you are communicating, it is your human readable language. And the operating system will convert that into binary language, okay. It knows only one language, that is binary language, that's it, okay. So but here this containers doesn't have any OS, so how it will contact to the hardware, for RAM, for hard disk, for CPU and all. Your containers doesn't have any operating system. It has only the file system which are required to run your application, okay. File system, in this is, you know, in Linux we have this root file system, right? Under root file system, what we'll have, like a root directory, okay, lib, okay, lib64, okay, bin. So these are the directories which we have under root file system, okay. Sorry, it is dial, I told you, it is file system, okay. So this root file system which is required to run your application, that will be created according to the operating system. Let us say if you create a Ubuntu kind of Nginx server, then for Ubuntu, what are the file systems we have? That file system will be bundled and it will be created for the container, okay. But we need to download the, we don't have any ISO to create a containers. Those are called as images, okay. So now let us follow that is a secondary, okay. Now here we have a physical server. I have installed a software that is like container software, and then I'm creating my containers, okay. So these containers are lightweight. What is lightweight? Lightweight in the sense it doesn't have any so many services running in the background because it doesn't have any operating system, right? It will run only the service which is required and your main application, that is Nginx web server, okay. Whenever it requires a hardware resource, then it will talk to the physical server operating system, and then it will convey the message to your hardware. The way it is communicating to the operating system, it will use a channel called namespace. Okay, namespace is nothing but which is an isolation created, a channel created in order to convey the message from one device to another device within the operating system. Okay, if you want to transfer the data of this particular server only through this channel, means why I'm trying to create a namespace, because the data which is passing from this OS base machine to the Nginx should not affect by another container. So you should not send the packets in this my channel, right? So that's the reason we are creating a namespace. Totally we have 7 types of namespaces. types like process namespace, memory namespace. Okay, there are other namespaces. For each and every resource, it will create a separate namespace for that particular container. His data will be transferred only through that particular channel, which is created from, okay, this container will be transferred in that particular namespace, in different namespace, which is created for him. So every container has its own isolated namespace, isolated in the sense partitioned. Okay, all the data will not be transferred in one channel, it will be transferred in different channels. Okay, how you take our apartment, we have a pipeline straight from the tank. So each and every pipeline will go to that respective house. Okay, so everybody is not using a single, everybody is not going to the tank and they are collecting the water, right? Everybody has a pipeline to their own house, flat. Okay, here also it's the same thing. So I have a separate channel in order to communicate to my hardware in the physical server. Okay, and the advantage of using containers, because at any point of time we can create a container within less than 1 second. Within 1 second we can create a container, and you can test your application. Whether it's a developer, he can create a container. Whatever, let us say a developer is developing certain code. Okay, unfortunately his virtual machine is crashed. Then it's how much time he need to waste in creating a virtual machine. Okay, so if virtual machine is crashed, all the data which is written of his code is present in the virtual machine. The data itself is lost, right? If he's using external storage, that is well and good. Okay, but let us assume if your virtual machine is crashed again, I need to recreate a virtual machine and test my application, because I need to transfer the data, application data, to my virtual machine. So that will take at least half an hour to consume. It will consume half an hour to create it, to make it live. But in containers, even if your container is crashed, within less than 1 second, we can create another container and we can transfer our data and test the application. So how much time you are saving? Almost half an hour time in testing it. And in one physical server, we can run, compared to virtual machine, we can run twice or five times of your virtual machines. Let us say if I can run four virtual machines here, containers, I can create more than 20 or 30, 30 containers or 20 containers. And one more thing we need to remember, it depends upon the application which is running in the container. If it is using a lot of resources, then we need to, we can limit the resources. Let us say, like for a container, we can say the limitation, like it should use only one CPU, 1 GB of RAM, and one core of CPU. That, like, we can specify. But by default, if you don't specify anything, it will increase the resource according dynamically. Dynamically, in this sense, let us say now this application requires only 2 GB of RAM, it will take only 2 GB from the physical server. Now let us say this application is also taking only 2 GB. Now there are so many people who are hitting to this particular app. Now it will start increasing the RAM which is present on a physical server. It will increase dynamically, no need to do from our end. Okay, if you want to restrict that, then we can set the margin saying that it should not use more than 4 GB. Okay, whenever it is not required, it will reduce the RAM. Whenever it is required, it will increase the RAM. So the increasing process, the changing of RAM will be dynamically. Okay, but the only disadvantage of this Docker containers is nothing but the single disadvantage we have is nothing but whatever the base we have. Let us say you are running a Windows operating system, we can create only Windows containers. We cannot create a Linux containers. Cross platform cannot be done in this particular scenario. In virtual machines, physical server can be Windows, but here we can install Linux, again Windows Server or Unix operating system, whatever it is. See, when we have these many advantages in Docker, why we will consider about this? It is minute, right? This kind of disadvantage. Okay. Here, if you are using a Linux operating system, we can create only a Linux containers. We cannot create a Windows containers. Okay. If you want a Windows containers, we can create one more physical server and we need to install Docker for Windows, and then we can create a Docker of Windows containers. Okay, so that is how we need to do. Okay, so what is a Docker? Docker is an open source. Docker is one of the application which is used to create a containers on a physical server, lightweight containers. And Docker is an open source, and we have enterprise edition. We have two types of versions. One is like open source we have for testing purpose, and we have enterprise edition. If you install enterprise edition, they will give you a license key. The license key AI will be available for a certain amount of years, and then you can get a support for it. Okay. GSK. So what is this for? Email address and phone number. Okay, we'll discuss of the offline on this. Okay. So the containers Docker is nothing but it's an application which is used to create containers on top of your physical server or virtual machine. We can also install Docker on a virtual machine also, and we can install on a physical server. We can install on a cloud server, but in AWS they're directly providing a container that is called as ECS, Elastic Container Service. Okay, so that you can see in AWS account. You can log in if you have an account, and then you can see a container technology for a separate service for it. Even Google also providing it. Actually, this container technology has been built by Google team. They have developed it in 2013. They have released into the market as an open source. Initially, we don't know like from how many years they are using it, but internally Google company is using this particular Docker technology for to run their applications. Imagine how trusted it is. Like the Google applications are like more heavyweight, right? So many people are hitting to that particular applications. They are running on a Docker containers. Okay, imagine we can also run our production applications and we can run our testing applications, everything in a Docker containers. Okay, in Docker, what are the syllabus we are going to discuss is nothing but, first of all, we'll be discussing in our course. Okay, I'll tell you about Kubernetes later. First, let me tell the syllabus of this. Till now, we have understood what is this Docker. Okay, why it is different from physical servers and virtual machines. So this is the revolution which has started right now. Okay, now, so in this entire course, we'll be teaching about what is Docker. We have done in the demo and what is Docker and containers. Okay, we'll be teaching on it. Okay, and after that, we'll be discussing about VM versus container. Okay, and then we'll be discussing about networking. And networking, in the sense, we need to understand networking before this. Okay, and apart from this, we'll be understanding about software switch. It's like what do we say, open vSwitch or Linux bridge. Open switch and Linux bridge. Okay, so these tools are required because how will you create a network for your containers? That is like software. So you need to understand how they are trying to create. I'll just give you an overview. It is not like we need to learn in depth of this particular concept, but at least you need to understand something on this. And overlay network. This topic we'll discuss first. Okay, and after that, I will explain about discussion on LXD. Before Docker package is available, how we can create a containers using LXD package. That we'll be discussing on it. Discussion on LXD containers. Okay. And after that, I'll be teaching about Docker overview. Again, we'll be starting with that, and Docker architecture we need to discuss. Okay, and after Docker architecture, okay, we need to discuss about Docker architecture, in the sense how your Docker is working, what packages we need to install, what kind of operating system we can use, how it will contact to your physical servers. Everything we'll be discussing in a Docker architecture. Okay, and then we need to understand what is image. Okay, and what do we say, like image. Okay, Docker Hub. Okay. Docker Hub is nothing but GitHub kind of thing, where we can store all the images of a Docker in one particular centralized location. Okay, so that we need to understand. Okay, container layers in container. Okay, so there are other topics which we can discuss. After that, installation of Docker. It is called as Docker Engine. There are many other tools in Docker. In Docker Engine, we'll be discussing about storage. Okay. We'll be discussing about network, how to create our own network. Okay. Storage. Okay. Application which can be accessed from outside, which is called as port forward. Okay. And then we have, we have discussed about storages and all, mapping and all, images. So many other things which we have. Okay. Once it is done with the Docker engine, whatever the experiments we have done, we'll be taking each and every tool what we are discussing, we'll be taking a real time scenario. And whatever the tools I have told, right, from the scratch, I'll be showing in my system with the projector. Like if it is online, like complete online session, right? So I'll be showing in my laptop, I'll share my screen, each and every step I will be executing, and I'll be showing you what are the advantages and how we can use it to our production servers or whatever it is according to our requirement. Okay. If you understand what is the advantage of it, then you can understand where we can use it, right? So that is how it works. Okay. See, whatever the platform you are working in right now, whether you are a network engineer, whether you are a software engineer, or you are a tester, or you are a developer, whatever it is, they need to have an OS running in the background to test their application or to run their application or to deploy an application, whatever it is, they have to know about operating. But running the application in the physical server is a bit tough. Virtual machine, it is also a bit tough. If you're running your application in the container, it's like at any point of time I can create it. Okay. So don't worry about the platform which you are working in right now. If you have like good amount of experience, we can tell that internally I'm working in this company with certain project where Docker is also installed. They're working with. So I have pretty good experience on Docker. That like everything we can cover to the, see, if you technically strong in this particular Docker and Kubernetes, then that is secondary. Okay. That is the secondary thing which they will be asking in the interviews. Okay. But don't worry about it right now. It is like, which can be ignored. Once the Docker engine has been done, this concept is done, we'll be discussing about Docker Swarm. Not Swarm. Before that, I need to tell you what is Docker machine. Docker machine is nothing but, let us have three physical servers. On three physical servers, I need to install Docker. Now, how will you do that? Do you know about Kickstart installation? Let us have 100 servers in my company. On 100 servers, I need to install operating system of Linux. So physically, I cannot go to each and every physical server and install the operating system, right? So we can use a Kickstart kind of thing where it will contact to the centralized server and it will install the operating system. Just we need to boot it. That's it. So we cannot, it is not required to wait till the operating system is installed. Just you need to start the machine, boot it, change the boot order, then automatically it will contact to the Kickstart server and then it will install the operating system. And here also Docker machine is nothing but, in order to install a Docker engine on all the three physical servers, now it is not required to log into each and every three physical servers and install the Docker. Nothing, because sometimes what happens, in one physical server you will install one Docker version, and second server you might got the latest version, and so we'll be installing the latest version. So both the servers are mismatching, right? One physical server is having one Docker version, and second physical server is having second version. So that is like mismatching it. If all the physical servers need to have the same version, same package and everything, same dependencies, then we have a tool called Docker Engine, which will be installing Docker on all the multiple machines, and it can be managed from your Docker machine itself. How we have VMware vCenter, right, in the market. So similar to that, it is to manage multiple Docker engines. Okay, that is how we need to learn. And after that, we'll be learning about Docker Compose. Okay, Docker Compose, it's not more required because these advantages we have in Kubernetes. So we are not discussing about it. Directly, we are jumping into Docker Swarm. You need to understand Docker Swarm. Docker Swarm is like cluster technology. Okay, Docker Swarm is nothing but, let us say you have three physical servers. Okay, on three physical servers, okay, using Docker machine, you have installed Docker on all the three servers. Okay, now if I want to create a container, I need to log into any one of the physical server and I will create a container. Let us say you are keep on creating the containers in one physical server. What happens after a certain time period, it will, your resource will be entirely used. So you cannot create more than specific containers, right? Then what will you do? You log into the second server. Until unless you have gone through the failure, you don't understand that the resource has been used by all the containers. Then what will you do when you're facing some error? You'll go to the second machine and you will create some containers, right? So once that there also the containers or you keep on getting created, and after that the resource got full and you're not able to create more than that, what will you do? We'll log into the third physical server and you'll start creating it. See, every time I need to understand when something is going wrong, that the physical resource has been used, so I cannot create a container. So as a like as an engineer, this is not the appropriate way, right? So what I want to do, I need to manage all the three servers which of creating containers. I should not log into each and every physical server of Docker installed. If I log into one server, a centralized server, the centralized server, if it tries to use the command, that should contact to the any one of the physical server which you are having resource, and then it will create a container. Okay, so let us assume like this. I will wipe out this and see, just write the syllabus, and after that we'll be discussing about Kubernetes. So whatever the things it was written in the prospectus, all the topics we'll be discussing about Kubernetes, and one practical session of that, how to run your applications and all in the Kubernetes and how to access it from outside. Okay, so these are the things we have, and we'll be not only this, we'll be discussing about other topics like how the companies are using this Kubernetes right now in the market. So all these topics we'll be discussing in it. Okay, so let me explain about Docker Kubernetes right now. Let us say this is the machine which you have installed Docker, and here I have installed Docker, and here you have installed Docker. Okay. Now Docker swarm is nothing but you will create one more server. Okay, let us assume this one. You will create a centralized server. Now it is not required to log into each and every machine and create a container. Okay, let us assume it is a Docker engine. And here we have Docker engine. Okay, now it is not required to log into each and every machine and create a container, because you are facing some problem, right? You are accessing only one physical machine. Now instead of that, from the Docker swarm itself, swarm server, if I try to execute a command like create a container, automatically this swarm will contact to any one of the server. It will contact to this or to this, okay, or to this server. Okay, it will contact to any one of the three servers which we have. Okay, and then what it does, it will create a container for you. Okay, it will take care of launching the container on whichever the physical resource you have. If this server is full, automatically your Docker swarm will search for another physical server if it is integrated, and then it will create a container, or else it will go to the third physical server and then it will create a container for you. Okay, so these are the advantages we have with the Docker swarm. Not only that, we have different advantages. Okay, so why we are going for this is the Docker swarm, which is nothing but clustering your Docker engines and creating from a centralized server. Okay, and we have a Docker swarm. So why we need to go for Kubernetes? Kubernetes is also the same scenario. Kubernetes, let us say I have different worker nodes. Okay, Kubernetes is called as the orchestration tool which will create a Docker containers for us. Okay, not containers, actually we have other advantages like pods, services, duplication, replica set. Okay, deployment, we have endpoints. There are so many other things which we have in Kubernetes which are not available in Docker swarm. Okay, if you want to go for cluster, simple cluster, then we can go for Docker swarm. If you want more advantages of container replication and all, then we need to go for Kubernetes. Kubernetes, it's a tool which is used, a cluster kind of tool which is used to create an orchestration of your application. Orchestration in the sense, you'll write a YAML file. See, all these Kubernetes will be writing a YAML file. I will be teaching about YAML file too, how to write this particular YAML file, what are the syntaxes we need to follow. Okay, in this YAML file, we'll define what should be the container, what should be the container name, what should be the image, everything we'll specify and we'll create it. Okay, so this is called as orchestration. Orchestration in the sense, define your resource in one particular file and execute it. That is called as orchestration. Okay, so according to the file, whatever the things you have specified, according to that, it will create a container for you. Okay, now here also we have a centralized server in Kubernetes, which is called as master. Okay, and this master server will be managing all the worker nodes. These are called as worker node one. Okay, we have worker node in the sense where Docker is installed. Worker node 2, we have worker node 3, and then we have node 4. All these worker nodes will be managed by your master node. Okay, all these worker nodes. All these worker nodes will be managed by your master node. So what master node will do when you execute the Kubernetes command, the Kubernetes command actually before that it will check which worker node is having a resource to create a container. It will monitor it and then it will tell you to your Kubernetes command which you are trying to execute, and then according to that it will transfer the information to that particular worker node. Okay, here the worker node will take the information, it will give the information to the Docker container, so Docker engine, and Docker engine inside in all the machines will be installing a Docker engine, okay, with the same version that Kubernetes will take care of it. Okay, and your Docker engine will take the resource and then it will create a container, and that information will be given back to your master node. Okay, so all this master, these worker nodes are managed by your Kubernetes node. So what are the advantages we have in Kubernetes? Let us say if any one of the container is down, automatically with the same resource it will create another container, so there is no downtime, right? When you're running an important application, I don't want a downtime, right? So don't want a downtime in the sense when I'm running an important application, we should not have application downtime. So what happens, your Kubernetes will create with the same resource, it will create another container. Okay, so that is how it works with the Kubernetes. So that is called as replication. Okay, so and we have pods. Pod is nothing but grouping the containers together. So let us say I have application. So for our application, I have database and Nginx server. Both the servers need to be running on one physical worker node. Then what we'll do, we'll create a pod. Pod is nothing but group of containers running for an application. Okay. And we have services, we have endpoints. There are so many other things in Kubernetes. Okay. So nowadays, everybody started working on Docker. If they are going for single application need to be run in the like single physical server, they want to maintain an as application, then directly we can go for Docker. If you want to use a cluster kind of technology and all, we need to go for Kubernetes. So Kubernetes is like mostly used in the current organizations. Wherever you see, they are talking about Kubernetes. Why we are learning Docker? Because without learning Docker, you cannot learn Kubernetes. Okay, that is the basics which we need to have, right? So that is how. So how will you know the DNS installation on a Linux server? First of all, you need to understand what is Linux operating system, how it works, what are the commands we have. Then we need to step into your database installation or like DNS installation on the Linux server. Without learning that directly, you should not learn about servers, right? So here also in Kubernetes, first of all, you need to learn about Docker, Docker Swarm, what are the technologies we have, how Docker Swarm is different from Kubernetes. Everything we'll see into the entire course. So this course will be taking for 40 days. Excluding your holidays or including it, it depends upon the situation of the syllabus. If syllabus is not going happen properly, then we need to take on Saturday or Sunday, any one of the Saturday and Sunday. If not, we can go for on daily basis. Okay, so that is how it works with Docker and Kubernetes. Okay, in Kubernetes, all the topics we will be discussing, and we'll be testing a real-time scenario. We'll be taking one application, we'll be designing it, and we'll be testing on a Kubernetes. Okay.